So it's Saturday, and the News 24 and Sport 24 teams are glued to the Rugby World Cup final. Obviously, we're working, we're always working, but we're working while watching the rugby, and we are filing updates in one of our breaking news WhatsApp groups. You know, every organization has one, we've got one too. And in between all of the messages coming through and our reporting staff kind of filing their updates, a very stoic senior member of our reporting staff, I'm not going to name him, just posts one line in the WhatsApp group, and that's, "I'm crying." And I just laughed. I mean, we all just laughed at him because really he kind of expressed the sentiment of just what we were feeling over our imminent win over England in the Rugby World Cup final. Of course, we did win it. Oh, we won it spectacularly. The country went absolutely berserk. And very senior journalists crying over our win was just the first in a long line of very funny things that happened that day. We had old Faf de Klerk in the tightest South African flag speedo I have ever seen, meeting royalty. We had our boys in green and gold drinking out of the Rugby World Cup trophy. Then, of course, we had them arrive at OR Tambo just to rapturous applause and singing and dancing, and South Africans from all walks of life just joining together to celebrate them. And then we had Mapimpi drop the F-bomb in a press conference.
Maybe 5 minutes, I was like, I don't think I'm gonna. Sorry about that.
So, you know, it's just true South African style. Rugby brings us to our knees and makes us do things that we wouldn't normally do. And that's what we're talking about this week on The Story. We won the Rugby World Cup, 3 times champions, and you know what? I think we can be a little bit smug about it. You're listening to The Story. It's a new podcast from News 24. Every week, we're going to take you inside our newsroom. We'll speak to journalists and experts about the week's biggest story. This is what we saw, heard, and uncovered this week. Sport 24's Rob Howing is in our Cape Town studio, and he's joining us now to chat a little bit more about Bokmania, the Rugby World Cup, and, you know, what it means for us as a country. Rob, thank you so much for joining me.
Hi, Jerusha, my pleasure.
So, I mean, I don't even know where to start. What an overwhelming result. Had you called it from the beginning?
I'm afraid not. I didn't call the Springboks for World Cup glory as a whole. And when they got to the final, I have to admit that considering the excellence of England's performance the week before against the supposedly almighty All Blacks, common sense had told me that the Boks had, you know, a realistic enough chance, Jerusha, but I wouldn't have said more than a sort of a 50-50. So I gave them a 45% chance of winning. And the spectacular outcome, it was such a pleasure to get it so wrong, because the Boks were just magnificent on the day, that they really genuinely saved their best for last, a performance worthy of a championship.
Yeah, so I know my husband and a lot of people after our win went back and kind of hate read all the BBC and British commentary that was really snotty ahead of the final. Old Matt Dawson saying that if he could choose a squad, he would only choose English players. And we sure showed them, didn't we?
Absolutely. You know, plenty of egg on face places on that side of the planet. I was just one of the people who made very sure that that Matt Dawson's tweet about no Springbok cutting the current England side went out to a bigger platform, and that hopefully the Springboks would get wind of it as well. It's the sort of thing that you think, well, it would be quite nice if the coach put a little message like that up on the dressing room door, just to remind the guys that it might give them a little bit of an extra push to want to excel in the final. And I have to say that the Springboks look like a seriously fired up, motivated, but also very clinical and sharp, composed looking crew. It was a truly majestic performance, especially in a final, when finals can be very dour affairs in world sport, not just in rugby. World Cup soccer finals are often pretty tepid affairs, you know, which drag into extra time and penalties because they're so cagey, so high stakes. And yet the Springboks actually played with a certain sort of panache, you know, in the final as well, which was particularly pleasing.
Yeah, I mean, two tries in a final, it was beautiful to watch.
It was. It took something like, 220 or 230 minutes of World Cup final rugby for us to finally cross the chalk for a try. And what a fantastic try it was to Makazola Mapimpi. And then Cheslin Kolbe just put a cherry on top by, stepping his way through four or five very bamboozled and tiring English defenders to dot a second try. And frankly, come the final whistle, the Boks were the team still on the attack and looking like the team who would have been the ones to add yet another. You know, so majestic was the sort of extent of their dominance on the day.
It really was beautiful to watch. Rob, rewind for a moment, take us back and describe to us, you know, what was the feeling and the expectations of our boys going into the Rugby World Cup? I mean, I guess I'm asking, were we slated to win this thing, or, you know, what was the feeling when we started?
No, definitely not. I think that the best emotion you could have installed was sort of quiet optimism. We knew that we had the players across the park to be able to deliver a competitive tournament. The vast majority of fairly level-headed, less than sort of excitable, if you like, South African supporters would have thought, you know, let's just see if we can get to the semis. Let's see if we can get a sort of credible place on the podium by finishing third or as runners-up. And not in their wildest dreams would they have really, at the end of the day, staked their houses on the Boks doing it. So that really puts in perspective just how earth-shattering, you know, the triumph really was.
Yeah, and speaking of earth-shattering, I mean, the response now as the Springboks are back on home soil, taking that cup around the country on a tour. I mean, I don't think we've experienced anything like this since, 2010? It's been extraordinary.
It has. It's taken us all by surprise. I think it certainly took the South African Police Service and various staff at OR Tambo by surprise, because they didn't seem fully prepared for what was to come. I really felt sorry for the Springboks, as they landed in sort of dribs and drabs and all flights from various corners of the planet, coming back in sort of waves. And of course, they were all completely knackered.
Yeah, Rob, I got the impression that the whole country was kind of in shock, and our officials and the staff at ORT were totally in shock too, because when they got off that plane, it was very clear that everyone was so excited and there was just no rhyme or reason to what was happening.
Yes, that's right. And in some ways, that sort of chaos was almost, an extra little sort of attribute in a sense. It demonstrated the sheer passion of our sporting public. And also it was a reminder of the kind of the hunger that had finally been sort of satisfied, because we have been, through some very tough times. You mentioned 2010. As perhaps being the last time that we all sort of felt a real major tangible sense of national pride and unity in sport. That was through, simply hosting the World Cup soccer, which is, as big as it gets in international sporting terms. But we haven't had anything like this in terms of actual, tangible trophy-holding glory in one of our major sports for some considerable time. As you know, our cricket team has still not won a major ICC trophy for many years, and the World Cup in cricket remains incredibly elusive. Some signs of rebirth among Bafana Bafana, I suppose. They did pretty well at the last AFCON in Egypt, which is, something to cling to. But this really was manna from heaven for South African sports fans and society as a whole, of course, given the sort of the challenges that we've had.
Yeah, and that was, I think, some of what really touched the nation. Rusi and Sia just being so realistic about those challenges that we face back home, and really using this win as a way to inspire and encourage South Africans too. But Rob, what I really want from you now is for you to just give us a view forward. what happens now? Talks of a new coach. How are we going to cling to this Rugby World Cup glory and ensure that we keep performing?
Well, the good news really is that although Rassie Erasmus steps down from the actual portfolio of head coach, he's going to just very much sort of evolve his existing role as director of rugby. I think it's still very apparent and pretty obvious that he's still going to sort of wear the tracksuit, as it were. In other words, he's going to stay very hands-on. The vibe does seem to be that Jacques Ninaba will be the one stepping into the head coach shoes, but Rassie is a very diligent planner, and as much as the present is so important, he is always very religiously looking into the future in terms of getting structures in place, having sort of a next cabs on the rank in terms of players who might be retiring, knowing who the successor will be. So, you know, I think there's more to look forward to with this particular World Cup winning Springbok group than there was perhaps in either of 95 or 2007, when we kind of, you know, we sort of plateaued with the World Cup and then sort of took a bit of a bounce, a bit of a sharp fall afterwards. I think the Springboks will stay right up there for the next 4 years of the next World Cup cycle to France 2023.
That's a really exciting thought. That's Sport24's Rob Howing. Rob, if our listeners want to get in touch with you via Twitter, how can they find you?
They can get hold of me on my Twitter handle, which is at Rob Howing.
Thanks so much for speaking to us today.
Thanks, Jerusha.
Joining us now from Cape Town is News24's Kamva Somdiala. He spent some time in Port Elizabeth in Sia Khaleesi's hometown and really got a sense of what Sia means, not only to the people of Zwide, where he's from, but also to South Africa. Kamva, thanks for chatting to us today.
Thank you for having me.
Kamva, through your reporting, I guess everybody just walked away with the sense of immense pride that Sia's hometown have for him. I mean, from his primary school mentor, his high school coaches, just generally people on the streets even. Man, PE loves Sia, right?
Yes, they do. During my discovery of what Sia represents to people both in his hometown of Zwide and in the city side of Port Elizabeth, is that here there is an inspiration and a figure of hope. When we had visited his former club, African Bombers, I asked the coach of the team, I asked, do these young rugby players understand and do they know the Sia that we are now portraying? And the coach said to me, they definitely understand and they know Sia, and we want to instill in them that confidence and hope that you work hard and you put your mind to it, there's ample opportunity that's available to them.
Yeah, and I think the thing that really touched so many of us was that Sia acknowledges his background when interviewed by ITV in the UK, yes. For instance. He, you know, the interviewer asked him, did you ever imagine that this would be you? And he said, look, as a child, all he thought about was getting his next meal. He's just been so realistic about the reality that so many South Africans face. And I think that just endears us to him even more.
It certainly does. And he always makes a point of saving a word for the underdog. And it comes across because he was an underdog himself. And what I picked up from his latest press conference after they arrived from Japan was that train hard, work hard for that opportunity, because it will present itself, and when it does present itself, one needs to be ready. And visiting his primary school, Mtsingeni Primary School, the teachers and the school kids there, they all appreciate and acknowledge the significance of Sia. They acknowledge what he means to them and the hope symbol that he carries, and I would imagine that during the next couple of months when he does go back to his primary school, that it'll be an even more jovial mood given what he's accomplished and how much they respect what he's achieved.
Tell us a bit more about that, Kamva. Sia going back to his primary school is not unusual at all. In fact, he visits regularly, and as I understand it, he is even involved in an initiative that gives the primary school kids iPads.
Yes. He recently donated iPads and he donated school shoes to the children. And like you say, it's not unusual for old scholars of schools to go back and give back. But this one has that added significance to say this is the Springbok captain who hails from where we are right now. And we're able to put a face to a name where we know that there are endless possibilities for us as well as we grow up.
Yeah, it's enough to give you goosebumps. Kamva, thank you so much for speaking to us today.
Thank you very much.
The Story is a weekly podcast by News24. It's hosted by me, Jerusha Sukhdeo-Raath, and this week it's produced and edited by Sharlene Rood, with help from Al Colstock in Cape Town. For more on this story and many other stories, visit news24.com.